Yeah, thanks. Okay, I'm happy that you are still here. It's in the late afternoon and really happy to be here again at Blockchain for Science Con. And yeah, let me ask you first if your uncle would ask you tonight, okay, please explain me the self-sovereign identity thing, please, yes? Would you feel a little bit confident to be able to explain this? I want to show of hands. Only very few hands. I'm happy about this because otherwise, okay, I would be screwed. Great. So, yes. And how about decentralized identity? If your uncle would ask you to explain decentralized identity, what about then? Would you be confident to be able to explain? No, hardly. Okay, good. Great. So, let me just skip across the intro of TIB. I'm a librarian working at the German, at the Leibniz Information Center for Science and Technology, TIB. If you are more into that kind of stuff, look it up at tib.eu. You find more from my current or day-by-day working things on Twitter. I'm Lambo on Twitter. And let's dive right into the topic. So as you know, identity on the internet is really fishy, and it's really a hard and very persistent kind of problem, right? So normally the proponents of self-sovereign identity put it this way, that we have kind of three subsequent generations of tackling this problem. The first one, so represented here with the classic New Yorker cartoon on the internet, nobody knows you are a dog, you all know that one, is represented by the approach that you have services normally sitting on some .com website, and they allow you to establish an account with them. So proof that you are there somehow on the internet is that you have this account, so that you share some secret with that site or service. The downside of this is, as you all know, who of you uses a password manager? Please show your hands. Okay, that's okay. The rest of you, please get yourself a password manager. I'm not joking here, it's important. But it's a mess, you know that, right? So, and the thing is, this is really not sufficient, and people have been aware of that pretty early on. So they moved to another generation of things, and that is identity as a service. So you have an account only with one, or no, not actually, not only one, but this is another part of that problem, but only with very few big providers of identity, like, for instance, Google or Facebook, and then you reuse that information that is sitting, the personal information that is sitting about you with them, when you want to enter another service, right? And so the common way the Web 2.0 was framed is this famous Time Person of the Year title of 2004, where they said, okay, the person of the year is you because you create all of this content and you are highly active all over the internet. But in reality, it looks like more in this collage where these identity providers become tremendously powerful. And by the way, small footnote, I don't need to explain that to you. It's very convenient, not only to you, but also for the surveillance state, because there's only one or very few providers who know almost all of your whereabouts and what you do on the internet. And then we have the third generation, so the story goes, of the self-sovereign identity people. And please don't believe me, but rather have a closer look on the seminal blog posting by Christopher Allen from 2016 about self-sovereign identity. I don't put the link here, just Google it, you will find it. And that third one is to say, okay, I want to own my personal information. the person about what I do, what I'm allowed to do, and so on. This should continuously stay with me. And I should have full agency and the power to control where I apply it and where not. And this is basically this concept here, like in the old physical days. And to this audience here, I don't need to explain you why the concept of a wallet also applies to the digital world, right? So we have a similarity. I'm not talking about cryptocurrencies here, but it's still a similarity. We have in cryptocurrencies this slogan, not your keys, not your coins, which is very true and very important to understand this concept. And the same is true for credentials, right? And so it's moving from here to there, obviously. Okay, now let's dive into what happens in the background if you want to make this true. The idea of credentials in an identity wallet app running on your smartphone or so. In the last few years, within the W3C, but also within the Decentralized Identity Foundations, a couple of very interesting standards were formed, mostly around the concept of decentralized identifiers, or DID for short, and verifiable claims. If you don't know these standards yet, please look them up. Super interesting, you will be impressed by how far they have come already, although even here in this very specialized audience, many people have not that much heard of it now. Super important stuff. And so I will very, very roughly, very superficial here, of course, because of time reasons, go through the terminology and the basic concept of decentralized identifiers. So the idea is that you are the holder with your wallet of some credentials. You receive them by an issuer, and you apply them against a verifier. So you, for instance, if you apply for a job, you take that credential that you received from your university that proves that you have some diploma, so it can be easily automatically processed by the verifier, and it's not up to you to prove this again and again every time, because the credential is digital and cryptographically secured from the get-go. And what happens here is that every time, so now we are into the DID standard, right? Every time I receive such a credential, I establish a unique connection to the issuer by setting up a cryptographically secure pseudonym. So I receive a credential, or to be more clear, a number of very fine-grained, verifiable claims about my person. I put them to my wallet, and at the time I want to show them to a verifier, for instance, in this case I made up with a job application, I establish another pseudonym relation to the verifier. So I make sure that the verifier knows only about me what I essentially want him to know or her to know. And even if that same person receives this kind of information about me from different sources, they cannot correlate because of this pseudonymity thing. So this is pretty interesting. And then in every case of digital certification, you would ask, okay, how do I verify the digital signature with my verifiable claims? And how do I make sure that the issuer can even revoke these credentials at any time. And therefore, I need some medium that allows it, without interference of any third party, to make sure that the basis, so for instance, a digital signature key, gets stored on the long run on that medium, and that it has a very good uptime, independent of if the issuer is willing or is able to give that data to any third person. And when I describe this medium in that way, you already know what I'm talking about. It's a prime use case of a blockchain, right? Best it's a public blockchain. So, and the interesting thing is that it is a very highly modular use case of a blockchain. So there are people who say, okay, we can just scrap the blockchain part. We can still apply the standard, but instead we use just a distributed file system by IPFS or so, like IPFS. But it's a pretty good use case. It's pretty interesting. And there are not so many other use cases of blockchain. This is already telling and a little bit interesting, where the W3C is already supporting this development of standards. And it's a very, very basic question. I mean, I just talked a minute ago with Gerrit, another librarian in the audience, ha, librarians, about the proof of existence approaches. And Gerrit was saying that this is all very nice, but without identity, many of the use cases for proof of existence are somehow broken. Because you would only prove that something was there in the past at a certain point of time in the past, but to relate to some piece of information has a huge additional value in many use cases. So you need identity in many, many cases. So and now the usual advertisement block in between. We are running a Horizon 2020 funded project named QualiChain, where we apply all of these concepts in higher education. And just hypothetically spoken, how many minutes do I have left? 18 I have left?
Yeah.
Ah, okay. Okay, great, wonderful. So I can slow down and... No, just joking. So the thing is, in the US, it's pretty common. I mean, Michelle would know more about that, I guess, that if you apply for a job, you do not have to give away your gender or your ethnicity. So for instance, maybe not even your name, right? Because you can derive certain things about that. And with this kind of technology, that gets much orders of magnitudes easier. And this is beautiful, yeah? Because an employer is hurting itself when the employer is sorting applications by gender. And so this is a huge benefit to have this in a very simple digital way underpinned by such a concept. Or imagine you are Sönke. You are a very micro provider of scientific events or learning, educational events. And you want to allow people to take this credential away back home to their employer that they visited this event here. So there's a prohibitive barrier for Sönke to give out certificates, because this would require so much additional bureaucracy. I know that he has enough to do already with this event, right? So it would be great, and this is typical for digitalization all of the time, to have this more common, easier, just a wallet app, yes? If Sönke would have a decentralized identity app that would allow him just with a click on his smartphone to give all of you the credential, I would be sure he would just happily do it, right? And this is the underpinning for this kind of applications, where you have like credentials on a micro level, yes? Issuers on a micro level, or small contributions to a project. Things like that. Or imagine you are a student from Tehran, right? And maybe you have even some digital certificate about your university diploma. But then, as it happens, you have some globally operating provider of certification infrastructure, of diploma. And then, since it's sitting in the USA, the USA decides, okay, no, we feel not good about this. We do not want to provide this kind of service to Iranian universities. What do you do then, right? So therefore, again, this medium that allows you to make sure that everybody can verify your credentials without interference of such a big, important third party than the US government. Or last things, very subtle here, but maybe interesting. You learned a lot from Michelle about the GDPR. Yeah? if you happen to want to make sure that your decentralized identity solution is really strictly GDPR compliant, you will be super interested in these standards as well. And we in our community, we tend to go over these GDPR requirements a little bit like with, let's see how we get away with that, right? But maybe sometimes it's serious and you should make sure that it is really, that it is basically at least possible to be compliant, right? Sorry.
Just send out the attendee list of the conference.
Yeah. Yeah, and sometimes people ask me, okay, but why is it so important to make sure that a diploma is not forged somehow or so? And in the context of Germany, maybe it doesn't happen that much. But this is not the thing. I mean, to have diplomas and stuff like that in higher education, or even smaller things like credentials about that you contributed a peer review in science or so, to have this digitized once in a very robust manner and make sure that things can be processed in a much more efficient way. It's not about the probability that one particular credential gets forged by somebody, right? You get me. So and to have this level of automation, you want to make use of this of the possibilities of blockchain here. So and now another little bit subtle thing. Although DID is all about exchange and social relationships, it is not actually about decentralized autonomous organizations or tokens. Let me make this clear. So if you, let's assume we are living in a smart city and our employers certify the micro fact about us that we that our workplace is in a certain part of the town. And maybe we have some homeless people, they don't have an employer, but their shelter provides them the same credential because it's almost free, why not? So then we would have a latent community of people who can prove that they live in this part of the town. And the local authority could easily ask them about a certain decision that is to make, right? So this is a neat example of latent communities of people who relate to each other to certain very particular credentials they share. And this is immensely powerful, if you think about it. You can do a lot of this with this. And there's a lot of disruptive potential here, right? And of course, now, you could say, therefore, DID could also be a super interesting building block for a DAO or some other Sybil-resistant kind of peer-to-peer network. You get me, right? So with this kind of stuff, you could basically come up with a proof of individual personhood or something. Super interesting. But let me challenge you a bit. You have all lots of blockchain-related ideas or even running initiatives and projects. And ask yourself, I would challenge you to ask yourself, is blockchain for what I do really necessary? Because often we put a field that we know about from our own experience, for instance, research, because we are researchers or work in a library or so, we put on top of this some new social mechanisms that we just introduce by using a blockchain. So we introduce some incentive system or so. And often, in many cases, this might be valuable and interesting, right? But we need to take care if we really need this kind of stuff. And as you hopefully have, as I have shown you here, for having an exchange between pseudonymous, self-sovereign, borderless identities, you don't need that much of a blockchain. So in some way, yes, it's convenient, but it doesn't have anything to do with incentivation mechanisms or monetary value transfer or things like that. Think about this. I think it's really useful to be analytic about this and think about where we really need new incentive mechanisms. So after Dave gave his talk about artifacts, somebody from the audience asked, okay, are you introducing some new incentives? And Dave's answer was super interesting and super reflected, and I liked it a lot, because Dave said, no, we don't need to, because it's already in place and it's citations. So whatever we do here for artifacts, we would just allow people to apply the concept of citations that is already there to more stuff. And this is very reflective and very interesting. Okay, enough of the propaganda. Let's go on. How will it look like in the real world? And I would say just look on Korea. It's really amazing to see what is happening there, because, okay, it's a fine print. Maybe look it up on CoinDesk. It's from a few weeks ago, but it's an unfolding story from the last month that, many of large tech firms like LG and Samsung are sitting in Korea, and you have the telecom providers, the banks, the educational sector, these IT companies, and then some more players, and they agree that they want to start kind of a self-sovereign identity landscape for everyone, for everything in Korea. And this is pretty exciting, because with these large new concepts, you always have, you know this very well, this kind of chicken and egg problem, right? So it only feels valuable and interesting if you have issuers, holders, and verifiers, right? You need to have everybody on board, and that's kind of hard. So therefore, this is super interesting to have a nation where this is sitting high at the top of the national agenda, kind of. Let's wait what happens there. But maybe a little bit more hands-on. Another example is what is happening in British Columbia, which is a province of Canada, as you might know. And there you have already lots of things running in their GitHub repository. Look it up. They had this idea 2 or 3 years ago that if you have a startup in Canada, it should be much easier for you to go through all these bureaucratic bottlenecks, right, to register your business. And therefore, they came up with a landscape of self-sovereign identity tools that allows this. And they even have so-called recipes. So you, after you have one step ready with your new business, you automatically go through the next authority and get the next permittance or whatever. And it feels almost, from the user experience side of things, like a wizard. But actually, there is not one centralized website that stores all the information about you, but it's completely different authorities operating under different rules, national law and local law and so on. But with self-sovereign identity and identity wallet apps and so on, it becomes pretty easy. And this is a pretty convincing example. And at least when you look at this, you come to think, okay, when does it happen in research? When will it be comparably easily to maintain your own identity as a researcher online? And okay, one footnote to the last examples. They are operating with the sovereign blockchain, which is a permission blockchain. We heard a little bit about another permission blockchain today, Bloxburg. And as you know, with very good reasons, you might be doubtful about this approach, but I can tell you help is underway. So the Decentralized Identity Foundation is working on something that is called Sidetree Protocol, where you have, these standards are very modular, and they take care that you can verify certain DID documents that are stored on a distributed file system against Bitcoin or Ethereum, whatever you want. So this is a drop-in replacement with an open public large blockchain And yeah, if you like that better, just have a look on at their GitHub repository, Decentralized Identity Foundation. Forgetting to mention, Microsoft is on this as well. They are working on an implementation of that protocol, which I think is pretty interesting to have Microsoft in this area. But now we are not there yet. We have still identifiers that are maintained in a more centralized way, like ORCID. Still, I would ask you not to ignore them. It's important to understand that they are already geared towards more researcher autonomy. And I think we can grow together. In last year, we had, there was somebody from ORCID who gave a talk. I'm not sure if I remember this right, but it was mentioned. So they are also interested in developing themselves. And okay, last slide. So I like the 1990s, and I both liked a lot Microsoft Encarta. Yeah, I even bought the CD, I was that dumb. And I also liked the Wiki web from Ward Cunningham. And in retrospect, this was a pretty similar situation maybe, because Ward Cunningham was just a single agile developer who was toying and playing around with HTML and what else you could do with these new standards, right? And you all know what happened later. 6 years ago or so later, somebody said, okay, let's set up another interesting little game. We call it Wikipedia and try, based on this simple HTML-based open thing or kind of thing, to establish an encyclopedia. And at the same time, Microsoft started Encarta. And you know what? They started with 25,000 articles and multimedia. And it worked. I had it on my Windows 95 system. I remember this very well. And so on the first glance, you would say, this is super successful and interesting because you have the entire ecosystem created all at once, while this is totally lagging behind, and why would somebody would find this interesting? But it shows that focusing on standards, setting some building blocks, allowing people to come up with new things by themselves and toy around with what you found out on the long run can be much better. That's all.
Thank you, Langer. Thank you, Langer. Very, very important topic in this nice approach. You need to hear it once, and then you understood it. At least you can, like, if you go over.
Okay. Maybe so one or two questions.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, so one or two questions. So we don't need to bring our driving license anymore. We can just prove it to the authority, right?
Yeah, it will become a super interesting information market. There is a lot of monetary value in there, right? Because the Department of Motor Vehicles or so will give you maybe some credentials and you can reuse them in unpredicted ways, because at some other place you might use them to prove that you are above 18 years old or so.
So how, if I do verify some claim from some user, how can I verify that this claim was issued by a, how can I trust the issuer? Oh. Anybody could have been the issuer.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So in fact, you end up with this. This is also another 1990s reference. That's nice. Anybody remembers PGP and the Web of Trust?
Totally. Yeah.
Okay. So that was a decentralized approach to maintain a public identity on a key server and collect verifications of other users. And we will end up with something like this. And you can also do this.
Well,
in a very,
but it didn't work out.
I mean, you can have a mixture, right? You can have an infrastructure that is nearly unbreakable because blockchain and so on. But it's at
the
same time...
You're talking about a web of trust, basically.
Right, but it can also be used by government authorities, for instance, right? So this will be an interesting mixture and interesting to see. We will have a very open layer of information for verification of signatures and so on. And still, you can have old governance models that use that layer, so to say.
Yeah, thank you. No more questions, and thank you again, Lambert. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So.